We welcome you again to World Class Sunday School. It's always a pleasure to have you join us as we continue to read and study God's Word. Let us go in prayer. Lord, today again, we are thankful and grateful to you for this opportunity to share in your Word. We pray that our hearts and minds are open to what you are teaching us, that we have a desire to learn more about you so we can serve you better. It's in Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks and praises always. In our summer quarter, we're talking about hope in the Lord. And here in Unit 2 that we are currently in, we're experiencing hope. And today's lesson is entitled Delightful Precepts. We should find God's Word to be delightful to us. And we're going to look again today into Psalms. Our printed text today is found in Psalms 119, and we're going to look at verses 73 through verses 78. We have two outlines that's going to guide us today. The first outline is requests for wisdom. Psalms 119, verses 73 through 76. And the second outline is hope for the future. Psalms 119, verses 77 through verse 80. Okay, here in Psalms 119, it says, Psalms 119 takes up the art of living in an almost obsessive way as it repeatedly turns to the same ideas and figures of speech. It emphasizes the law of Moses or the Torah, the first five books of the Old Testament, as a guidebook to a life of dignity and moral integrity. And this Psalms is a poem. It's written in an acrostic style. Okay, it says that Psalms 119 takes the form of the extreme of this type of writing. Okay, it includes eight consecutive lines beginning with the same Hebrew letters. Okay, in English, it would be like eight poetic lines that start with the letter A. Then the next eight would start with the letter B. The next eight would start with the letter C, and so on, so forth through the alphabet. But these Hebrew letters, it says the 22 Hebrew letters multiplied by eight lines equals 176 verses. And that's how many verses that's found in Psalms 119. But let's turn our attention back to the emphasis on 119 being the guidebook for our lives as born-again believers. Okay. In our last session in Psalm 71, in this section of Psalms 119, it portrays God as a teacher and the psalmist as a pupil. And that's the sense that we're going to look at in today. And the student is learning the commandments, the law of Moses, not merely as a set of arbitrary rules, but as a window into the meaning of life, and by providing a clear structure to everyday life. And then this section of Psalms that's teaching the law invites us to an inner peace, openness with God. And we're going to look at our first outline here. It says requests for wisdom. And that's found in Psalms 119. We're going to look at verses 73 through verse 76. Okay. Now remember, God is the teacher, and the psalmist, along with us, we are the people. And it says, God and his people. Verse 73, the hands have made me and fashioned me, giving me understanding that I may learn the commandments. Okay, in the beginning here we see the A part of verse 73 talks about the hand of God that made me. This is what the psalmist is saying. Now we know that God is a spirit and he doesn't have hands as we perceive them. Hands here represents his work in earthly terminology. And so all of creation, God spoke into existence. You know, he spoke, and when he spoke, everything that he called into existence came to be. But man, God formed him from the dust of the ground with his own hand. And so here the psalmist is acknowledging that he was made and created by God. And then the B part of that verse, he said, give me understanding that I may learn thy commandments. We are all unique beings, like a blade of grass or a snowflake. No two are the same. He has a sovereign will for each one of our lives. Like Paul, we are God's chosen vessel. And like the psalmist, our prayer should be, Lord, give me understanding in what you would have me to do. And that's what that was Paul's expression when he met Christ on the Damascus Road. And when he said, Lord, what do you want me to do? And this is the psalmist here asking the Lord, give me understanding so he will know what to do. So that should be our prayer also. And then verse 74, that they may fear thee, will be glad when they see me, because I have hope in thy word. The faithful community, those who are like-minded, are believers. Here the psalmist is saying that they are glad when he comes on the scene. The faithful community, he calls them. He said, they cheer up when I come around. They feel good just to see him coming because he lights up the room. How do people react when you come on the scene? Are they happy to see you? Do you bring a cheerful attitude? Do you make people feel better when you're in their company? And this is the what he's expressing here. The first Psalms says that the man that meditates on God's word is like a tree that's planted by the rivers of waters, and whatsoever he do shall prosper. Let me just use first Psalms as a reference here. We're talking about, when we first started, we're talking about how Psalms 119 is, he's looking at it as a guide book for life. And first number of Psalms had projects the same idea. It says, beginning with the first verse in first Psalms, it says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And that's what we're looking at. We're looking at the psalmist here having delight in God's word and meditating on it and understanding it as a way of life. He says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night, and he should be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Okay, and so in whatever this man is doing, this righteous man is doing, the Bible said that he will prosper in whatever he's doing. Okay, then verses 75 through 76, we see it says, trust in God. Verse 75 says, I know, O Lord, that thy judgments are right, and that thou in faithfulness has afflicted me. Okay, so here, now we need to really pay attention to what the psalmist is expressing here. Remember now, we're in the classroom, we are learning through God's word how to incorporate his word into our daily life. And so we know that as we go through life, that we're going to face some obstacles. And here he's talking about being afflicted here in verse 75. And in molding us and teaching us, sometimes God has to allow us to go through afflictions. Now, they're not always comfortable. We don't ever want to go through them, but it's a part of maturing. It's a part of learning. It's a part of growing. And so God will allow afflictions to come into our lives. But the psalmist here is saying, in those times is when we really need to put our trust in God. He said, "I know, Lord, that thy judgments are right." We know God never makes a mistake. In those times of affliction, hardships, and trials, we want to feel God's love. And we find comfort in the arms of God. He says, "And that thou in faithfulness has afflicted me." In faithfulness, meaning that his love will never fail. Even when we are going through, God is there for us. He still loves us. He's still going to protect us. He's still going to provide for us. And we need to know that, especially in those times. God shows mercy to those who love him and keep his commandment. So our part is we should always love him and do his will. Do those things that we learn to do from his word. And when we do that, the Bible is telling us that God will show his mercy to us. And that's what we need. We need God's mercy. Not only do we need God's mercy in order to really get in the mindset of accepting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, but once we made that decision, then God's mercy, that same mercy that brought us to salvation, will keep us through whatever we go through. And then we had verse 76. It says, "Let I pray thee, thy merciful kindness be for my comfort, according to thy words unto thy servant." Okay, here in verse 76, he's still referring to those times that he would have to go through his affliction. And we need to know that God has promised us that he will never leave us or forsake us. And so when we're going through that, through those times, that's when we really need to know that God is with us. And we really need to keep our trust in him. Okay, and so moving to the second portion of our lesson. And here we're going to talk about hope for the future. Hope for the future. Okay. And we talked in our last session about where our hope is in Christ. And we talked about putting our faith in him, putting our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. I shall not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. And so here the psalmist is putting his hope in the future that God has laid out for his people, the great promise, the promise of a Messiah. And this is where the psalmist is putting his hope for the future. He says here, and we're going to look at verses 77 through verse 80, the righteous and the wicked. Okay, we looked at first Psalms, the first number of Psalms. In that Psalms, when you read it in its entirety, you'll see that there are two men, two people, one righteous and one unrighteous. Okay, let me just run through it again. And first number of Psalms said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law doeth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters that bring forth his fruit in his season. His leaves also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind bloweth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Okay, so we see two men, or two people, making two different decisions and ending up in two different destinations. Okay, we're going to see that here. He says, let thy tender mercies come unto me that I may live, for the law is my delight. And so here we, this thread that we see in First Psalms really runs through the whole Bible. And there are only two types of people, the godly and the ungodly. Okay, so that we see that here in these verses talking about the righteous and the wicked. Okay, so First Psalms shows two people, their destinations, their decisions, their directions of their lives, and then their destination. The righteous choose the word of God. The wicked does not. The righteous choose the way of God. The wicked chooses his own way. The righteous has eternal life. The wicked has eternal damnation. Two distinctions that we see as we go through this hope for the future. The righteous and the wicked. Okay, verse 7 and 8 says, let the proud be ashamed, for they dealt perversely with me without a cause. But I will meditate in thy precepts. Okay, here in this part, this portion of our lesson, he's talking about the proud, those who attack me because of my lifestyle or my belief in God, in God's word. Okay, those are the proud and arrogant ones, the wicked ones. And we can avoid a lot of abuse and discomfort by not concentrating on those who abuse us. But when we concentrate on God's word, we can avoid a lot of abuse if we not just concentrate on God's word. He said here, about those who were mistreating him for no cause. He said, but I will meditate on that precept. And look, it will do us a lot of good if we keep our mind stayed on the word of God instead of concentrating on negative stuff. And then beginning with verse 79 and verse 80, it says, trust in God. Trust in God. Let those that fear thee turn unto me, and those that have known thy testimony. Okay, here the psalmist desires the fellowship and the friendship of those who fear God. He's talking to the community of believers, those who are of the same mindset concerning God. He's saying, let them turn to me. And those that have known my testimony. And so the psalmist is designed the friendship, the fellowship. When Paul was in prison, most people abandoned him. Now there were a few brave the danger of being known as his friend. When he came to trial, nobody stood by him. In 2 Timothy 4 and 16, Paul says, no man stood with me, but all forsook me. And that's the same thing happened to Jesus. Facing the certainty of death, Paul experienced loneliness. And the psalmist here feels the same loneliness. And he just wanted to be in the fellowship of believers. There's nothing like being in the fellowship of believers. There are a lot of people who have turned, since COVID, have turned to virtual worship. Virtual worship is, I guess it's okay. But that's for me. I just prefer being in the presence of other believers. Because there's nothing like being in fellowship with other believers. You can worship virtually if that's your thing. But just being among other believers is a far, far different cry from worshiping virtually. Okay, and then verse 80, it says, "Let my heart be sound in thy statutes, that I be not ashamed." Okay, like Paul, the psalmist wanted to be sound in the faith. Okay, now you know, just having intellectual knowledge of divine truth is not enough. Just head knowledge, knowing what the Word of God says, that's not enough. If you stop there, then the real purpose of Scripture has been missed altogether. He says, "Let my heart be sound in thy statute." This psalmist, he wants to make God's word. He wants to put it in his heart. He said we must get sound doctrine, not just in our heads. That's the beginning, to get the knowledge. But we want to get it in our hearts. We want to get God's word in our hearts. The psalmist say in another portion of Scripture, he said that he wanted to hide God's word in his heart so that he wouldn't sin against God. And that should be our desire, to get the knowledge of God's divine word, but not just knowing it, but to get it in our hearts. And that's making it a part of who we are. So we'll know how to live day by day. And because you're not going to always have a Bible in front of us, we need God's word in our hearts so that we'll know how to act and react. And when you have the love of God in your heart, when you have God's word in your heart, then whatever you go through, you're equipped to handle it then. And so we need to go beyond. Now, remember now, we are in a classroom setting. God is teaching us. And we want to first learn God's divine word. But we want to go farther than just learn it. We want to make it a part of who we are. And when we have God's word in our hearts, then we have everything we need to withstand anything that we have to go through. This psalmist, and we can see by his expressions here that he was anxious to get the word of God in his heart. And he knew that getting it out, getting God's word off the page and putting it in our lives, that's what really makes the difference. When we take God's word and use it in our daily life, that's when we're growing, that's when we're maturing. And God is gonna bless us as a result of it. We'll be blessed. A lot of things we go through, we'll be able to handle them because we know what the Word of God is saying to us or teaching us in those situations. He says, "Let my heart be sound in thy statutes, that I be not ashamed." Okay, when we stand on God's word, when we make God's word a part of our lives, when we meditate, like the psalmist is saying, on God's word, and we see here as a result our direction as we choose God's word. We see our direction, and then we see the destination, where we're going to end up at. And because of that, we should be anxious to get God's word in our heart. And when our hearts are right, we have nothing to be ashamed of. And we can see here both the psalmist, Paul and the psalmist, knew that God's laws are just and righteous. Not only are they just and righteous, but they are motivated by love and compassion. Man, look, what a blessing it is to live. Now, you're talking about an abundant life. If we can get in this place where we are anxious to get God's word in our hearts, and we know that his word is just and righteous, we know that they are motivated by love and compassion. And look, if we can get to that point, we like the psalmist can say, Lord, teach us your way. Lord, teach us your way. Say that with me. Lord, teach us your way. Thank you, Lord, just for loving us. Thank you because you are God and our creator. You have fashioned us and you continue to shape us into the image of Christ. Help us to understand to whatever degree we can to your gracious movements in our lives. You care for us, you created us, and you equipped us with every good thing that we may do your will. And we give you praise, glory, and honor. It's in Jesus' name we pray and give you thanks and praises always. Well, friends, again, we thank you for joining us on today, and we look forward to having you in our next session. So until then, may God richly bless and keep you, is our prayer. And to our internet guests, we're going to continue to remind you, if you haven't already, to please go down and subscribe to this cast so that when we come up, you'll be notified. That way you won't miss us. And also share with your family, your friends, your Sunday school classes that we're here so they too can join in and be blessed by the Word of God here at World Class Sunday School. Somebody.